everyone, and welcome. Due to the sunny weather, it's even more special that you are gathering here. We will do the presentation today in English, as we have a guest, Anuška, from Slovenia. I hope that is fine with everyone. We don't really have like a strong concept for this next 90 minutes, because when we gathered together and discussed it, we also thought that it would be more interesting to include you to discuss the matter of the future of investigative journalism, because it's not black and white, it's all very grayish and colorful. My name is Julia Herrnböck. I will give a short introduction to the people on stage. To my left is Anuška Delić. She's investigative and data journalist from Slovenia. We are very happy to have her here today as our guest. She's working with OCCRP, the Organised Crime and Corruption Reporting Project. She's the founder of Austria, an investigative journalism center focusing on the Adriatic region. She just founded it in April last year, so it's also very interesting how she can tell us about financing such a project. And she's a member of ICIJ, the International Consortium for Investigative Journalists. So welcome, Anuška. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
My name is Julia Herrnböck. I'm from Austria. I'm a journalist and focusing on in-depth reporting in politics and corruption. Currently, I'm working for the non-profit investigative platform Dossier and also for the Pulsvier News. And yeah, I'm working for Reporters Without Borders in Austria, and I'm researching about the impact of investigative journalism at the University of Vienna. To my right, there's Florian Skrabal. He's a journalist and editor-in-chief and founder of the nonprofit platform Dossier in Austria for investigative and data journalism. He's also a member of Concordia Press Club and a university lecturer. And yeah, both of us will tell us today about the important work of cross-border investigations and collaborations and how to finance independent journalists. So I would like to start with you. How many of you have a print subscription?
Let me count. Can you keep holding them? 1, 2, 3.
And how many of you have an online subscription? Okay, that's almost more.
Yeah, that's like great. 12, 15. Maybe.
So the question, who thinks journalism is outdated or journalism is not important anymore? Yeah. Who thinks that? No one? Okay.
That's good.
So we started our internal discussion about to define what is investigative journalism. So
and we immediately had an argument.
Yeah. So on the one hand, there's the point of view that you say investigative journalism is different than other forms of journalism, because there's one definition that I really like, that it's about the exposure of information about a public issue. So it must be in the interest of the public, that someone does not want reported, and that is revealed through digging of a reporter. That doesn't come easy, but it's really time and resource consuming. That takes a lot of time and therefore money, and therefore it's most difficult to finance it. And yeah, it's for the purpose of inspiring reform, which hopefully is true for most of the forms of journalism. But there we have the first agreement. If investigative journalism isn't it journalism in general? So Anuška, what do you think?
Are we talking about that now?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, so me and Florian, so we're all about transparency, so let's be internally transparent here. Florian thinks that there's journalism and investigative journalism. I think that there's just journalism. And I think that even for journalists that are not working on in-depth stories or digging deep, maybe just scratching the surface, it's not responsible not to know and use at least some tools, methods that investigative journalists are using, even in daily reporting. Because we have to be aware that with the mistakes that we make in, let's say, daily reporting, we are actively participating in spreading this disinformation. So it's irresponsible not to be at least a little bit resourceful, not to check and verify everything several times. Actually, I think that all journalists have to know at least the basics of investigating, so that they can use the basics in, you know, for quick production, for breaking news, for whatever. I don't know what the situation is like here, but in Slovenia, I have to say that the majority of so-called daily reporters don't know even the basics of investigating. So my view is that this is irresponsible today in 2019 for journalists. I think that everyone should use to a certain extent, not obviously for months like we do, because then you're not going to produce your daily story, but everyone should use it, so everyone essentially is an investigative journalist, in my view.
I disagree. No, I think there are different forms of journalism. I agree that journalism is about reporting the facts and to get as close to the truth as possible. So if I report some disinformation, if I report a lie, I'm not doing journalistic work. However, I think that there's a difference between a sport reporter who goes to the Nordic Championship in Seefeld, in Tirol at the moment, and reports what he sees or she sees, and discovering a doping scandal where you have to dig deep, where you have to go to sources, where you have to find hidden documents or hidden information. And that's not daily routine work that can be done in some newsrooms. And obviously there is a big problem that there is not enough research in the newsrooms. But I totally agree, like, if you spread disinformation, it's not journalism. However, I think there's a difference between reporting on sports or culture, writing some piece on a new opera, whatever, and, you know, digging for facts and maybe going for a story for 3 months, for 3 years. Sometimes it takes so long, especially about Panama Papers, for example, where you have 300 people or so working together. So that's I think where we differed.
It's not fair to compare. So you can't compare sports and culture events, journalists with, you know, I was speaking more about the sort of daily reporter kind of a person, you know, like people writing daily news and churning out news like we were talking about. I use the term that Nick Davis, the former now retired investigative reporter of The Guardian, used in the Flat Earth News, where he coined the term journalism. He basically also agrees with me that there's only journalism or there's churnalism, so meaning that journalists are just churning out news like a conveyor belt, just producing. So I don't think it's fair, not fair, but I'm sorry, you can't compare the two, obviously. I was thinking more of like the daily production. I do come from a daily newspaper, so in my mind it's like there's news and then there's sports and culture, you know, so maybe I should have been more specific.
I was also working for a daily newspaper and I hated it. Yes. I hated it because there's so much pressure, there's a deadline every day. Yeah. And you have to put a story out, because if you just go to the editor-in-chief and say, hey, I need another week to research,
but
I'm not filling my pages.
If you
now
were well-versed in methods and tools of investigating, it would be much easier to produce that one story, don't you agree?
It depends on the story. It depends on the story and the sources. However, I would like to point out another, or stress another thing, that I think in Austria, particularly, there is a misconception of what investigative journalism is, because we have so many media who are actually only quoting from investigative reports of, let's say, the state attorney or a police report or the court of auditors. And they're framing it or saying or selling it as exclusive news, as a scoop. In the US, this would not be, or in Germany also, this would not be considered investigative journalism, because the investigative work, the research work, is actually done by some official authority. And not by the journalists themselves. So in the US, they're calling this reporting on investigations and not investigative journalism. So there's a misconception here that a lot of media are selling the audience investigative journalism. However, they didn't do the investigating. They were just reporting it, and they're maybe only seeing a small fraction of the bigger picture, of the bigger truth. So that's easily also that you can be influenced by whoever gives you the leak, the information, the document.
Yeah, that's called leaked journalism or exposed journalism. That it's also, you know, it's a marketing thing to say that you have exclusive content. Anuška, what I would be interested in, the newspaper you worked in Slovenia, did you have time to do investigative reporting or other colleagues?
Yeah, I have to. Okay. Yeah. Not in the beginning, but I was working for the, so until 1st of April, I was working for the main daily newspaper in Slovenia, Delo. And actually the last well, 8 years or so of my time there, I was mostly working on investigations, and I actually the last 4 or 3 years I was working for a weekly section.
Okay.
So my deadlines were weekly. However, later on they became bi and more than bi-weekly because I was doing things that just simply were not you were not able to produce in a week or two. So I did have some time and some space to do that. But I have to be honest, I was one of the very, very few, not only at the Dela, but in the country.
And isn't Slovenia like a history or tradition with investigative journalism, accountability journalism?
the highlight of investigative journalism in Slovenia was actually at the just before we became independent from Yugoslavia. That was the late days of Yugoslavia and Slovenia, where the political weekly Mladina was publishing really tough stories, basically attacking the then Yugoslav army and the authorities in Belgrade. They had huge leaks from the army documents. It was insane. They were doing really great. But since then, no tradition. And actually have to agree that's something we can agree with. In Slovenia, it's just like here. So you quote, they get a report from the police and it's investigation. However, it's even worse. It doesn't happen as often anymore, but it used to be very, very common. We always get anonymous letters, right? So journalists would take the anonymous letter. Most of the times you can't, it's very hard to verify what is in the anonymous letter, especially not within a day or a few days. And they would just call the people mentioned in the anonymous letter and ask them, you know, there's this anonymous letter, what do you say? You know, what do you say for yourself? And this was sold as investigative journalism, which, you know, it is not, definitely. It's not even journalism.
I think there's a difference also between Austria and Slovenia, because in Austria, the legal framework is actually not very good. We don't have a freedom of information law.
Do you have that in Slovenia?
We have a very good freedom of information law.
Does everybody know what freedom of information law refers to, means?
And ours is from 2003. Mm-hmm. The first one.
Uh-huh. So it's
so like you are way behind in Austria.
Lovely.
Yeah, I think Austria and one other are the only two countries in the at least OECD world that don't have this Freedom of Information Act, which means that
it's the only one in the EU.
Austria?
I think so too. Yeah. We're the last.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
So it means that every citizen has the right to get information on public information, and every journalist by there as well. And as we hear, we are the only country in the European Union and two in OECD countries. We don't have that right. So there's Amtsgeheimnis and we don't have Freedom of Information Act, which is something that Councillor Kurz promised in 2013 that will come, and now it's not looking like it's
not coming. It's not even on the agenda.
Yeah.
It's not opportunistic to to have a
and it's such a it's such
law.
A powerful tool, it's such a powerful law, because it enables every citizen, not only journalists, to ask for studies, to ask for numbers, to ask for information from public bodies, and you, because you have this right, this law in your favor, there you don't have to actually make friends with people working in the ministries. Today in Austria, it's often that you get exclusive information from ministries, from public bodies, because you know somebody in there, and this person often is expecting some favor in return. So you get one information, you have a scoop as a journalist, but you're actually selling yourself in a way too, because it's expected the next time, maybe you forget to mention something, or it works on several levels. And this is often happening in Austria.
But we have the so-called...
Can I add something?
Yeah, just one thing.
Sorry.
We have the Auskunftspflichtgesetz in Austria.
Yes.
How is that a difference?
But the Auskunftspflichtgesetz
is like the little brother of the Freedom of Information Act.
Tiny little brother.
No, can you translate the really long word for me?
Auskunftspflichtgesetz. So we have some part within the law that allows us to get so
little
information. It's a part of Freedom of Information Act, yeah.
Oh.
So for example,
like an orphan, maybe, not really a little
brother. Yeah, the unliked orphan of the government.
The problem is that the Auskunftspflichtgesetz is an einfaches Gesetz, it's a normal law.
Uh-huh.
And the Amtsgeheimnis
is a special law.
The secrecy law is a constitutional
law. Oh, constitutional. Okay, yeah. I know so you have a thing in the constitution for which, because of which you, it's very easy to fight all attempts to install a freedom of information law. But the good thing is that the majority of EU member states have good freedom of information laws. The way they are exercised, that's a big difference. There's a big difference in that, but generally we all have pretty good laws. And the good thing is that since we are collaborative journalists, we collaborate across borders. If there's a document in, you know, that is held by Slovenia and Austria, maybe Florian cannot get it in Austria, but he can get it in Slovenia, or I can get it for him. So
you have to think reverse.
Exactly. Yeah.
That was actually the case in we bought Eurofighters, the planes,
the jets,
and the journalist from Austria. He actually got access to the treaty in Great Britain.
Exactly.
Because it was built there by BA Systems. So you have to think reverse and try to work around it, but it's actually a real restraint in the journalistic work if you don't have this access to information.
It definitely is, because it's one of the most important tools a journalist has, regardless of whether he's investigative or not. but the problem, though, is... Okay, I'll just mention this. We won't... It's a side topic, but the problem is at the EU level. The EU level freedom of information... So access to information at the EU level to get EU documents. That's a huge problem, too.
You did one big project about EU members of parliament. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah. In 2015, I gathered journalists representing all EU member states to file a request with the European Parliament to access data, documents on how the members of the European Parliament spend their allowances. So that's the professional allowances, the money that they receive in addition to their paycheck. And this is, so by saying professional allowance, it means that it's an extra money that they receive solely, exclusively, to exercise their public duties. So that's like, I don't know, accommodation, office costs, and so on.
How much money are we talking about here?
We're talking about 4,400 euros net lump sum for every MEP per month. So that's almost 40 million euros every year, which goes out the door of the European Parliament unaccounted for, because for that allowance, specific allowance, there is no documents. And then there are other allowances, travel allowance, daily subsistence allowance, staff. So the money that they receive for staff, not only for staff, for ordering like reports, research, and so on. So we asked the European Parliament to hand over so these documents, the supporting documents for the spending, except the 4,400 euros, because for that they have no documents. With the European Parliament, and we were turned down. Then we went through the process of being turned down, finally, and then we took the European Parliament to court, the European Court of Justice. However, unfortunately, this September, the European Court of Justice sided with the European Parliament and basically stated that money that the MEPs, only elected officials in Europe, are allowed to spend only for professional expenses is their private data. Mm-hmm. Yay, European Court of Justice. You should know, though, that the European Court of Justice has its own problems with their spending, and we do suspect that they were actually basically protecting their own backs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Can we look what the next slide is, maybe? I'm not sure.
Because we forgot.
No, but I was not really sure where this is going, but when we talk about corruption and how independent journalism can help to fight corruption on a cultural level in a country, I think that the challenge for independent journalists in Europe is ineffective governments, bureaucratic culture. As you mentioned, it takes months and years to get even a conclusion. Then you have to fight this one conclusion again. And this takes a lot of resource, effort, and time. And most of the journalists, not only daily newspapers, they don't have the time for that. They don't have the discipline for that to go after something for 8 weeks or 8 months or 2 years. Then incapable courts who are not really efficient, and by that we have a feeling of being a disempowered and disinterested public, which is the biggest danger of not putting journalism in effectiveness. Can we go to the next slide, because I want to finish with something positive? And what are the opportunities? How can independent journalism help to influence the culture of corruption so it counteracts the atmosphere of cynicism, which is something that I think we all maybe detect on ourselves, and we see it in discussions and debates that a lot of people are just frustrated and think it doesn't make a difference if you get involved or not, because nothing changes. And very good journalism should help you see that there is a difference about reporting on things independently. But that it should accustom officials to inquisitive press so that they get used to, for example, in Austria, most of the time I'm calling officials with information about something that comes close to corruption. I get a very irritated answer, like just yesterday I got an answer from a ministry like, what is that, a strange question? Because they're not used that they're questioned and asked out of or above the daily business that they're doing. It should help implement a culture of accountability that people also, if it's, you know, I think it doesn't matter if you corrupt with 1 euro or 10,000 euros. It's a matter of fact that you should be very careful with public money. And just also officials get a feeling, and the public should get a feeling what corruption is and where it starts. And by that, independent journalism can help to reduce corruption in the country. So there are studies about that, why it is important also in Europe. And we still maybe all have the feeling that everything is going all right. But on the other hand, recent report shows that the free press in Europe is endangered if you look at Poland and Hungary and Slovakia. And there are a lot of countries where things are changing. And also there's a, you know, it's also starting to change a little bit in Austria as well, that officials attacking the free press. So yeah, what are your feelings? What is the recent situation of investigative journalism in your countries, in Austria and Slovenia?
Well, I think there is a lack of investigative journalism in Austria because there is a misconception, because there is a lack of money, and there is even a lack of culture within the newsrooms. Before I founded Dossier 7 years ago, I was working for the daily newspaper Die Presse, which is a quality newspaper in Austria, and I was supposed to do investigative work there. I was supposed to be a part of a team. I ended up being the team, so there was no one else joining, which made it a little difficult. But there was even raised eyebrows by colleagues in their own newspaper who wouldn't understand that you actually don't publish every day, that you need time, that you are actually sitting in a library somewhere in the basement of a library and not in the newsroom. So they would be asking questions, where are you, what are you doing? And then there's also this lack of culture that on a managerial level, that you get the resources, you get time and you get money. So for example, there would be a story playing in Styria, and I'd go to my boss and say, I would like to go to Styria. And the question would be, how much will that cost? Do we really need to go there? And this is basically, I mean, this is where you start teaching journalism, that you always go there where the story is. And you don't report it from your desk, but you have to go there. It doesn't matter if it's a train accident or some scandal. You have to be, or you have to feed food on the ground, and you have to be there. So I think there is an election on the legal framework, on the economic side, business side, and there is the problem within the newsroom where there is no support of this kind of journalism because it's risky. We started off Dossier, working Dossier with one thing that we can't let go. Some people say we have an obsession, is public advertising spending. So whenever there is the ministry or the city of Vienna placing ads in newspapers, which is an incredibly amount, it's almost like 200 million euros a year spent by public bodies and public companies to do advertisement. And there is some dependency resulting out of it. And so with traditional media, with newspapers, you would also have the argument within the newsroom to fight for the story in a way that, you know, maybe it's too risky because, I don't know, Raiffeisen is a big client and this is a critical Raiffeisen story. It could result in advertising money from Raiffeisen not going there. And that's even an issue with quality newspapers. It's not only the Yellow Press, Österreich, and Kronenzeitung, and Heute, but it's a problem with basically all traditional media, because where the money is coming from, this is where it gets very, very sensitive for everyone involved. But it's not that the stories, and they were very clever about how they turn off stories. They will not say, we can't run this story. I had one moment where I presented a story about public advertisement in the newspaper Heute, and the argument of the editor in chief was, we cannot only run a story about Heute. Please do the research also for Korea, for Österreich, Wiener Zeitung, Standard, Presse, for all basically newspapers. And the Heute story took 3 months to research. So
it's like saying, okay, do it until tomorrow.
I'm done in 2 years. Go do it. So it's not working this way, that they're just saying, you know, turning down the story by, hey, we're not bringing the story, but it's good work, and then placing so much work on the table that you can't finish the story, basically. So
I mean, you knowing the Austrian media landscape, and international-wise, there was a trend within the recent years to really grow their investigative teams again in a lot of countries, in the Western world at least. They established new investigative teams in the traditional media, and they're kind of hoping for a competitive advantage. Do you think that in Austria, those medias who are still investing money and sending people there and giving them a few weeks to do some piece, does it make a difference for them? Are they consumed more? Are they discussed more than the others?
I think, and if I would be a manager of a big media company, I'd advise them to do their own stories and investigative stories, because that stories they're only they we have, and not some, you know, news media story that from APA that runs in every, it's the same. Maybe you change the title, but the story is the same. If you do your own stories, your own investigations, you will have a competitive advantage, because you can only read the story in my media and not somewhere else. So I would advise for it. However, it's a costly and risky adventure. It's not that easy, as I pointed out. I think that in the U.S. and in other countries, there is a tradition of investigative reporting that's much stronger than in Austria. We do have very good investigative journalists in Austria, but they are like only working alone by themselves, like lonely wolves, what they call them. In the U.S., they actually have investigative desks. They have teams where there is a separation of workflows, where you, when you work in a team, you because investigative journalism often works with thesis, so it's like a social science, like writing a bachelor's thesis or whatever, master thesis. You put a thesis there, and then you try to verify and falsify it. And if you work in a team, you can have discussion at a very early moment in the work. And you can, if you only work by yourself, it's only your mind, and you can easily, you know, take the wrong turn and then get lost there. And not think about the other possibilities. So it has a lot of advantages. However, it has disadvantages, that obviously you need people who can work in a team. You need more communication. But I think, like in Austria, like Lucona, the ship that was sunk in the 70s by Udo Broksch, and there was this one journalist, Hans Bretteneber, who actually uncovered it. And reported on it. It's one guy, Alfred Worm, who discovered a scandal about the General Hospital in Vienna. It was one guy. Today, probably one of the most known journalists is Florian Klenk, working alone.
He's beginning to make a group. He's
actually, or Falter are part of the ICIJ, but it's still. There are a lot of stories that he does alone. I've known him for some time. I think that's a difference between international media landscape and Austrian media landscape or approach to investigative journalism.
You are involved in a lot of international organizations and working on collaborative projects.
It's because my country is so insignificant and small, I have to get.
So otherwise, you wouldn't do it?
More insignificant than Austria.
Much more, oh, yes. I mean, not now that we're sitting in the White House, now we're very important.
Can you tell us, maybe, for example, how one of these huge projects starts, by giving an example? Like, do you get a call or do you suggest something by yourself? And then how does it start, this work together with journalists sitting in other countries?
Oh, it really depends. It really depends. I mean, a project like Panama or Paradise Papers or Implant Files, these are all, yeah, you get a call, you get the call kind of projects. The MEP's project, for example, which ended up, in the end, we were 46 people, started from a conversation between me and my colleague from Denmark, where I was like, ranting about the directives in Europe to get this these documents, and why is it so hard when I can get it in Slovenia overnight, for example. The stuff that we were asking for the MEPs, I can get that in Slovenia no problem, for Slovenian MPs. So this happened, we have to do something, let's form a team and let's do something. So it varies. But for example, the Daphne project is a good one. The Daphne project is a project coordinated by Forbidden Stories, which is an NGO out of Paris that was specifically established to continue the work of imprisoned. Killed or otherwise incapacitated journalists. After Daphne Caruana Galizia was brutally killed in Malta, we sort of started talking with the OCCRP about, you know, the need to investigate not just the murder, but to continue the investigations. And at the same time, there was a separate group. There was a group on, you know, that also was speaking about it. And then we somehow met at the Global Investigator. I mean, we knew each other from before, but we, you know, word gave another. I mean, in a few seconds, we were already a team. You know, so that's somehow how then Daphne Project became this this investigation that joined everyone from Forbidden Stories to OCCRP to Reuters, Süddeutsche Zeitung, The Guardian, La Repubblica, IRP, so many media in Europe, at the sixth anniversary of Daphne Caruana Galizia's murder, which was in October 2017. So half year anniversary, we published the first investigations, and I just wanted to show a 2-minute video that the Forbidden Stories produced around the 3rd of May, so Press Freedom Day.
How did you finance that project? Who was financing Daphne Project?
Oh, this is not a question for me though, because that's the Forbidden Stories was the main coordinator on this, and this is I don't work for them, so I can't comment on that.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you think that you would go on, you know, investigating the stories of other journalists who got imprisoned or even killed, like Jan Kuciak?
Are we speaking about the Daphne Project or the
Forbidden Stories?
Forbidden Stories. Yeah. But that's not an OCCRP organization, so I don't know what their plans are. However, OCCRP, a similar project that we did a few years ago was when a journalist of OCCRP, Khadija Ismailova, an investigative journalist in Azerbaijan, was imprisoned. So Khadija Ismailova was really breaking ground in journalism in Azerbaijan because she uncovered huge corruption on the part of the government and the governmental family, so to speak, the Aliyevs. And she's been harassed by the government in various ways since 2010. In the meantime, also she was in prison. And at that time, OCCRP sort of put together the Khadija project, a project that was basically working on Khadija's stories while she was in prison, to show that, you know, the investigation, the stories, they don't stop. You cannot stop us. And this was a great project. It was also awarded many times. My colleague Miranda Patrucic, the best investigative journalist in the Balkans, in my opinion, was leading it. So it was a really great project. Then the Daphne project, and then unfortunately, yes, very soon after Daphne was killed, Jan Kuciak was shot. In Slovakia, along with his fiancée, Martina. And at the time, Jan was working on with fellow OCCRP journalists on the story about mafia's infiltration in the Slovakian government. And yeah, we do believe that that's why he was killed. However, Paula Holcova, his colleague from the Czech Republic, and the Italian reporters and many others were involved. We started investigating, of course, the murder, and we just published the 20th of February. It was the one-year anniversary of Jan's murder. And we just published on OCCRP a small series of stories about how the mafia became so powerful in Slovakia, and of course, the most important story of all, how Jan and Martina were killed. And that was a really tough investigation for my colleagues. I can't commend them enough on, I can't imagine the pressure to continue the work of your colleague that, I mean, they were working together for a year and a half before Jan was killed. Jan was very young and very, very, very talented. And it was horrible. And actually, the bizarre thing, we were just talking earlier about the freedom of information, not the bizarre, the very disgusting thing was that, according to some information, Jan's murderers got his home address, his personal data, from someone within the government, from his freedom of information request. So Jan asked for freedom of, filed the freedom of information request. This calls
as a citizen, not as a journalist, so with his.
It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter in Slovakia. It doesn't matter how you file. You're a person, regardless of you're just an individual. So yeah, there is very, very strong information that someone leaked his personal data, basically, to the murderers. And actually, they were killed in a house that they just recently bought, and they started renovating. They were about to get married and so on. So
how was the public response to these revelations about his death?
Oh, there were many protests in Slovakia, and you know, the government now changed, but I don't know if it really changed that much. Of course, there was a reaction, and there was a huge reaction in Malta also. Mm. But as we see, more than a year later, nothing's changed. You know, the EU keeps sending delegations to Malta. They all find the same things, that there's rampant corruption, that there's a problem with the financial system, with the banks and everything, and nothing changes. So you had a slide about challenges before, and I think, you know, the fact that we do a lot of work and then eventually nothing changes, that's a very huge challenge for our profession, because it did not used to be like this always, I think.
I mean, at least they arrested four people in Slovakia, no, who were involved in...
Yeah, but they arrested foot soldiers, just like they did in Malta. I'm not even mentioning it because I think it's like, it's like throwing sand in the face, or like, you know, fog, making fog. It's not the key. The key is to get the person or persons who ordered the murder. And actually, if you were wondering how much a life of a journalist is worth in the European Union, it's just a couple of 10,000 euros. Okay, so we're very cheap to murder.
Can we show the video now?
Yeah.
Yeah, great.
Oh, but there's no...
Daphne Caruana Galizia.
Caruana Galizia.
Journalist.
Killed when a bomb exploded.
Connected to the aggressive work she had done calling out corruption in Malta.
Nationalist consortium of journalists scrutinizing Malta as part of the so-called Daphne Project.
The group Forbidden Stories, an international network of journalists
designed to finish these stories and the investigations.
Implicated certain senior government officials in acts of corruption and wrongdoing.
We will keep pushing the Maltese authorities. We will keep pushing them. No stone should remain unturned.
So in my personal opinion, Forbidden Stories might be the most important organization right now in the European Union when it comes to independent journalism. So you can have a look, and if you want to support independent journalism, maybe it should be that, because they're really supporting journalists who are threatened within the European Union, which might be in Bulgaria, which might be in Hungary, which might be in Slovakia.
Anywhere in the world, if they are killed.
Yeah. But you know, we always think that maybe in Europe this is not a problem, but it is a problem. So this is the last slide, and we will leave it here, because the last days we discussed what we want to talk about today, because it's such a diverse topic, and basically we thought of five clusters that are somehow related to independent investigative journalism. So you have on the left collaborations, which get more and more important, also money-wise, because you share the costs, you share know-how, and on the other hand, you really increase the impact of your investigations because you spread it through several medias and you can do more, much more than an individual journalist and individual media. The goals of investigative journalism maybe have shifted, that it's even much more important than it used to be a few years ago. Maybe Florian can talk about that more. That we talked about the threats of the life of journalists, and we should talk about the legal and financial threats to investigative organizations, and also about the opportunities. And in the middle, you can see financing, and I put a crown on it because finance is king in this whole universe. So, yeah, Florian, let's talk about finance. How do you finance Dossier?
Difficult. The biggest challenge is getting money. That has been Dossier is an investigative newsroom, non-profit newsroom. We started in 2012, and we started with 3,000 euros. We got money from family, from the grandmother, and from friends and from fools, who just gave us 3,000 euros. Today, Dossier has a budget of around 300,000 euros. We don't accept any form of advertisement. We don't get press subsidies, because the system of press subsidies in Austria is basically, it stems from the 1970s. It's old. It only considers daily and weekly newspapers. So not even monthly magazine like Datum would get press subsidies in Austria. And us as an online media, we also don't get press subsidies. So we don't have the normal revenue streams that traditional media has. We also don't have a paywall, because our approach is that we say our journalism is in the public interest, so we want to reach as many people as possible with our stories, and to put a paywall in would contradict this principle. So we started developing our financial concept or business plan, because we started Dossier being five journalists and nobody having experience with business or managing, or so that was a bit of a problem. It still is, but we have grown to learn. Now we have Dossier now has three revenue streams, basically. So we do workshops and trainings. We also work together with traditional media and do research for them. For example, there is a political comedy show on Puls 4. It's called Bist du deppert, where it's about the waste of taxpayers' money, basically, for stupid reasons. And we are the newsroom in the background who's doing the research. And then script writers would come and write scripts and would make sketches. And they are very funny. We are very focused on the facts. So we're often fighting with them because they want to make the joke. And we have to tell them this joke is wrong. You can't do it. And now in fall of this year, there will be a new television show on the ORF by Peter Klien. He is the Willkommen Österreich reporter, and he will get his own late night show. And we will be, Dossier will be the newsroom or the team in the background researching his show. Hopefully, we have not signed a contract yet, but I'm very confident.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Is this investigative journalism? What are you doing there for the shows? Can you say that you do something in the public interest, or is it more to get money to do other projects?
Is it just research?
It is a mixture. I mean, if you define investigative journalism as a kind of a journalism that is actually elaborating und untersuchend, then it is investigative journalism. I like the definition of investigative journalism being a kind of an untersuchender Journalismus. I'm missing the English word now. And kind of examining journalism. If you're lucky, you have a scoop at the end of the line, but it's investigative journalism a lot about, you know, understanding system, understanding problems, understanding how things work so that you actually can do in-depth reporting and go to where it actually matters, to the core of a problem, and not just be scratching the surface. So in this way, this investigative journalism for me, if you define investigative journalism only by the headline and the scoop and the exclamation mark behind it, then it's not. But it's a form through humor, through political comedy. It's a form of reaching an audience that you would never reach. I mean, if you zap through the television and you have Puls 4 or F, and you have this comedy show that actually has serious content that actually touches everyone because it's our taxpayer money, it's our money, then you could probably reach more people than just, you know, publishing it in the Standard or on Dossier on our website, because you don't have the reach. So this is the idea behind it, to tell stories also through with humor or through comedy, and look for different ways of telling the stories. Mm-hmm. It must not only be comedy. I mean, 2017, we did a 10-minute animated graphic novel, a comic movie, a short film about Buvok and the Grasse affair. And it's also like most of it, it's not new that we are presenting here, but the format that we chose is new and maybe reaches younger people. Yeah, sure. It's 30 seconds or 40 seconds a trailer. Yeah,
so we have the trailer from this comedy movie about Kassa.
Fraud at the top of government.
If you are successful, you should earn money and you should be able to show it proudly.
It worked like a charm, but what goes up must come down.
What was my service? For who?
Your service was,
Yeah, please think for a moment.
For years, I've been investigating a single case. I've been trying to bring those responsible to justice.
Now I'm super naked.
I can really recommend you to look the whole Super Naked movie. It's 12 minutes on YouTube. It's really, you will understand the whole Buvok scandal suddenly, what is going on. It was really a very brilliant idea to present something that everybody has somehow information, but everybody's also a little bit fed up because it's too complicated. And suddenly everybody got involved again.
I think to investigative journalism or to journalism as a whole, I mean, you have the research part where you pick a story and then you do the research, and then you have the second phase where you actually try to tell the story, the storytelling. So we are also like experimenting with new forms of storytelling to see what's possible and how to reach people you would normally not reach. And this is why we are also working on movies like this or on television shows. But it also pays bills.
You made money by it?
The Super Naked, no.
No? We
lost money with it. But the television shows, we get money, and actually, like Pulsefia or F, eventually will pay for the work we do there. And we try to actually do that kind of work to finance our own investigations, our own story. So that's the second revenue stream that we have. And the third revenue stream, which would be the truly independent revenue stream, is through donations and memberships. You can become a Dossier club member. And just recently, we did our first crowdfunding. We crowdfunded our first print magazine, which we're working on it right now, and which we will be published by the end of March, beginning of April, about the Kronenzeitung. It will be a 100-page print magazine with no advertisement about journalistic evil in this country. I'm kind of biased. Yes, and this is we programmed our crowdfunding website, so we actually invested money in programming our own crowdfunding website, so we would not have to give 10% to other crowdfunding websites. And now that we've programmed it, we will do this crowdfunding moreover, and then maybe also with the second issue of the Kronenzeitung.
Because it was a very surprising effect. I remember when we launched the campaign in October, mm-hmm. Because crowdfunding for investigative independent journalism has never been done in Austria before, and we were really curious and nervous about the idea and thought, because we needed 60,000 euros to make the magazine, to just cover the costs of the magazine, not getting rich. And we thought this is way too much, and 2 months is not enough, and there's a possibility to fail with this campaign.
Yes.
And we were very surprised, and I think it's a beautiful sign, and maybe it's the effect of our new government, but we got the money within 18 days, not 2 months.
And now we're holding at 73, I would like 80. That's the problem with money, it can't be enough.
Greedy.
I mean, get greedy, yes.
But there were a lot of really nice comments out there, supporters who really, a lot of people said that, because the magazine is 20 euros. With 20 euros supporting the campaign, you get the magazine sent to your home, and it's totally free of advertisement. And yeah, a lot of people, I think, missing that right now. Good journalism that is not blinded for one side. There's also a very short clip about the situation of independent journalism in Austria. Maybe we can show that as well. It's in German, but it's only 2 minutes.
Zugang zum Dossierclub und fördern Journalismus im öffentlichen Interesse. Crowdfunding Dossier.at.
I think what the video said, under pressure from the outside and from the inside, we've been talking about the outside, but there is actually a lot of pressure on journalism from the inside, from the publishers themselves, who are like actually cutting personnel, cutting journalists, not giving you the resources. And also, we were talking about this prior, that a lot of what's happening in Austria's newspapers is not journalism at all, because it's just a hidden advertisement, and advertisement clients would pay for journalists to write journalistic articles, and it's not marked as advertisement and stuff, and this is just spreading everywhere. And so there's a lot of pressure from the inside, actually, and making journalism even harder. And we're not talking about Vice Chancellor Strache or Innenminister Kickl.
Anuška, you a few months ago founded your own investigative center. How are you doing? What are your plans?
I should say I'm doing great. Yeah, we've only been around for so little in a very small and insignificant country, there's no tradition of independent media really in Slovenia. There's one media that was founded, I think, 4 years ago, and it's focusing on investigating journalism, but local, Pod Črto, and they were the first ones really. I know they're having a very hard time, so. So we are having an even harder time, obviously. Oštro, the center I founded, because I had to leave Delo for reasons I am not allowed to disclose publicly, is going to focus on the sort of micro region, the Adriatic, Croatia, Slovenia, and the neighborhood. Because for one, it's very underreported. Croatia as a whole is a black hole within the fabric of investigative journalism in Europe. And so we are now working with a journalist there to try to develop her into a sort of independent, work-wise, independent journalist that she can start covering Croatia for us and for other organizations that need something done in Croatia, because now it's very hard to find someone there. And I'm half Croatian, half Slovenian, so I have my heart is always somewhat in Croatia too. So I sort of envisioned my center as filling this sort of tiny micro region here, and also there's a lot of environmental stories that are not covered, so many things. So lots of opportunities, lots and lots and lots of work, but the middle right there, it's more like a middle finger than what is on your screen. There's no crown for sure. But it's, so I don't know, I see it as a combination of what you were mentioning already, since there's no tradition. You were worried about crowdfunding 60,000. We're worried about crowdfunding 10,000. You know, I mean, because what kind of a message does it send if you fail, you know? And if you fail 10,000, it's worse than 60,000, I think.
In our calculation, we once wanted 300,000. I'm happy we didn't go for that. And only made 60,000 because it's a golden reach.
Yeah, but I mean, so Austria is something new in the sense, I mean, and Pochetto in a sense that they are, you know, depending on outside financing, so in you know, either grants or donations, and of course selling your knowledge on the market. But again, Slovenia is this small. You can't really, you can only sell your skills and knowledge so many times in such a small community. So, you know, we don't have the money that we need to function at all at the moment, if that was your question. But hopefully we will, you know, get it together within the next year. Everyone was warning me when I decided to branch out on my own. And I'm now working with two more colleagues, former colleagues from Delo, who also are not allowed to discuss the reasons for their departure publicly. So we are three now, all women, by the way. Everyone was warning me, like, you know, in the first year or two, you're going to have big problems, you know, before things start running. And we were prepared, but yeah, it's very, very, very hard. Not only because we're a small and insignificant country, but also because we're an EU member, or EU member state. So for example, if I had established my center in Serbia, or, you know, any other wannabe EU member state, I would probably get core funding within 6 months, very easily, if I had a good plan, of course, and project and everything. But there's just no core funding available, almost literally, within the European Union. So for those who are now scratching their heads, what is core funding and what isn't? So core funding meaning funding to do journalism, basically, to pay taxes, to investigate, to, you know, pay company registers for documents, whatever. And then project money. So project grants are grants for content, basically. So to get core funding so that you can actually do your job, it's very, very hard within the European Union because, well, this is my personal view, is that, you know, we have spent years and years and years in this cloud, this fog, thinking that, you know, media in the European Union, because we're a union of democratic states, you know, every member state has a functional media, free press and all that, so it's all beautiful, and let's deal with other things and the media is not important. And then in the meantime, when we were looking away, the crisis hit, you know, the whole conundrum with internet, print, what is going to happen with our income, profit, and so on. You know, everyone was in a crisis. And then, at least in Slovenia, things turned in a way where we are losing today. We are still losing young generations of journalists because they are literally out of college. They are dumped to sit at a table and just copy-paste practically, day in, day out. And there's no way that they can learn the craft of journalism sitting at a table copy-pasting news. Mm-hmm. And so there's literally generations that have been already lost in Slovenia to this. So it's a very specific situation. But regardless of all the whining I'm doing now, I am hopeful that within a year we will hopefully start standing on at least one leg, that we will prevail somehow.
Regarding finance, would you accept money from everyone?
No, we've already discussed due diligence on the people who are donating, of course. Yeah.
Did you ever have to give back money?
No, not giving back money, but we declined money.
Yeah, we have just declined something.
We've declined money
a few weeks ago.
The FPÖ wanted to put advertisement on our website. We said no.
But this was not recently.
Not this year.
Long time ago. Okay.
Yes, because we often report on the city of Vienna, and scandals there. And so obviously, like in the journalism world, if you report on the city of Vienna, which is ruled by the Social Democrats, in your research, you would talk to the opposition parties. So you actually, you try to get information for whatever, you know, is out there. So we know a lot of FPÖ members of the Viennese city council. That was offered to us, and other companies as well offered us money, and we are declining everybody who's not agreeing to the same ethical or human rights standards that are set, basically.
Criminal industries. You know, there's lots and lots, but I don't think that they would want to donate to Ostro, so I'm fine.
We would like to invite you to maybe exchange ideas how to finance journalism,
or have different other questions.
Whatever,
any question.
I just wanted to ask: do you think it's important for investigative reporters to work in a team for safety reasons? And is it for a publisher irresponsible to have someone like you call it a lone wolf because it makes him an easier target? And I think in the first years of Dossier, you didn't mention authors at the end of the to your stories. Was that some form of protection?
Should I go with the lone wolves and teams?
Please.
And then you. Yes and no to the lone. Of course, we are safer in a team, but we are the safest if we have financial stability and if we don't have thousands and thousands and thousands of euros threatening our lives with libel suits and so on. Daphne Caruana Galizia's family is today still fighting libel suits that were filed against. So the sons of the slain journalists are now fighting in court in cases that were brought against their mother, who is dead. So financial stability, not personal so much as professional. And I mean, we're all parts of networks, and if something, God forbid, happened to Florian, I would be in the first line of the, you know, standing and saying, yeah, we have to do something. So we are we have our backs, so to speak. For example, Pelin Unker, a Turkish journalist who was working on the Paradise and the Panama Papers with ICIJ, she was just sentenced to jail this.
experience that 1.5 years ago I did with another colleague from Dossier One investigation about money laundering from Armenia, from Russia through Armenia via Austria. And I was totally untrained for something like that. And it involved high-level government people from Armenia. And I knew that our colleagues from Armenia, from the team in Armenia, they got threats and we didn't. And I got really nervous about that, that I don't hear anything. And shortly after Jan Kuciak was murdered, there was a murder in the street in front of the office of Dossier.
Oh, yeah.
And it was like 2 weeks after, and colleagues of mine from my TV station, they called me if I know something because there are two people shot in the head in front of the Dossier office, and I couldn't reach Florian and the other colleague of mine, and I freaked out. I didn't ever tell you about it. But I never thought that I have these feelings in Austria. Never, ever. And this has changed as well, so I'm not feeling secure doing money laundering things that involves maybe organizations from outside Austria.
My favorite are corrupt politicians. Organized crime gets a little mafia. It's corrupt politicians. I like.
Yeah.
Journalistically. Yeah. Journalistically.
Do we have other ideas and thoughts and statements?
About podcasts, they're coming up now more and more, and this is a possibility, I think, to work together in a team. Mm-hmm. Isn't it? Or what do you think?
I think podcasts are a way of storytelling that's very cheap to produce, actually, and that's where actually the big advantage lies. And you can often, we're also thinking about doing podcasts about making offs. Like you have the story, you put the story on the website or in the magazine, and then you talk about how you did actually do the research, and that would be good for podcasts. But it's a very low level. And powerful tool to tell stories. Might it be investigative journalism or normal journalism? I think it's important, and a lot of media are doing it. Falter is doing it. No. We have 5 full-time employees and another 10 freelancers in the Dossier team. So we are a really tiny team, and we have a lot of ideas, but we just don't have the resources, the man and woman power
full-time
to actually do it, because it takes time. I mean, you have to sit down and do it. But podcast is so low level that we are considering doing it because it's cheap and you can do it kind of fast.
But my personal opinion is that the media all over the world are very nervous, and everybody's looking for a solution to find new channels to get audience attention and money. And like 2 years ago, it was video, and all the media offices, they started to look for people who know how to do video, and now it's podcasts. That's my personal opinion, but I think podcast is, it's a nice thing, and it's cheap to produce, and but I think content is king and form follows function in journalism, so we shouldn't be, get distracted by fancy things like data journalism and podcast and video. This is all second-guessed how to tell a story, but I think it's more important to get a really good story.
And that's how, like at Dossier, what we put the story in the center. You have the thesis, you have the research, and then you develop the stories. And somehow in the end of the process, you start thinking, okay, how do I have to write the story for social media? How do I write the story for online? How do I write the story? Because we often publish our stories through social media, newsletter, put it in standard, on online, or even in television. So we do the story, and then in the second step, we think about all these different channels, and social media, you have to be shorter, and blah 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 blah. So we take this one story, and then we try to spread it in all directions.
Do you want to do podcasts?
Actually, my two colleagues that are working with me, they have a podcast that they used to do at De La, and they will continue with it soon. Mm-hmm. But we're not yet at the stage where you guys at Dossier are, where you have a story and you can pick and choose how you're going to. For us, it's just, if we can make it to deadline, it's great. So
the story about the Austrian Ski Federation, somehow the ORF didn't want it. I don't know why.
The Austrian Ski Federation. Oh, not the Ski Federation. Oh, no, that's not the rape.
It's difficult to sell some stories.
That is always difficult, unless you're an independent media. Yeah.
I mean, what also has changed a lot within the last years is for the PhD research, I visited a lot of medias in the United States and Germany, how they push their investigative stories. And all of them told me that, you know, it's maybe 50% is the story. And that's, of course, your homework. The story has to be very good. But 50% goes into distribution and marketing in the meantime, because there's so many different channels now. And, you know, podcast is one channel that you're trying to increase your impact by reaching more people. And I think it's very good to differ on different platforms, to go social media, to go digital, to go maybe to a magazine, to do the same story, you know, to sell it to different audiences.
But it's also, I think also it's helping the story sort of live and be, it's helping people to understand it, because, you know, when you said the affair that the Buvak affair was too complicated, but then you showed it in the you know, in the short cartoon, and it's understandable all of a sudden, and you know, it's true. I mean, the stories that we do are really complicated, you know. I mean, even explaining a tax haven to people, and why does it matter to them?
The problem is that the one word can make the difference between being sued or not being sued. So
that is also, that is, so yeah.
Investigative stories, you have to write very precise. Because if you don't, then you get sloppy.
You have to put in more than you want to put in, because you want to not be financially liable. So it's a very tough thing to write a good investigative. So to do great investigation, but then also to write it. Luckily at OCCRP, we have really great editors who do very great rewriting also. So that always helps, because it's very hard also for the author to do that, because you're inside. You know too much already, and you think many things are important that are not so important for understanding. So it's quite a challenge sometimes to write a good investigative story. And also that it's read and spread wide. I see that many stupid things get tons and tons of clicks, whereas a really good important story gets 50 or something. And I'm looking and I say, why, you know? And it's probably because they're complicated, they're long. I don't know what it is. So it's great to have all of these formats and to spread sort of, I like the way you're doing it. Yeah, it's great.
More questions, one more?
Short one, just a short one. Just in case, I felt like I got a job for you being at the Dossier, kind of a story. What would I have to do being an ordinary individual?
Meet me after class.
That's all I wanted to hear.
No, call, drop us an email. Like, we sometimes get emails from persons who would like have, you know, hush mail. It's mail that, you know, disappears automatically after a certain time frame. We'll get emails, anonymous emails. I did once the story, and I've never met the person before publishing the story, but he was, you know, keeping sending me information, and I was checking the information, verifying it, and saying, hey, this is true. And the more information he sent, the more information was true. And then I published the story, and I only got him to meet him 2 months afterwards. And we talked about the story 2 months after it was published. So basically, there are all forms. It depends on how sensitive the story is. If it's really sensitive, I would not leave a digital trace. I would advise you to put it in an envelope and not go to the post office that's next to your house or employer, but go to a different district and put it in the mailbox there and just send it. So there's all forms of getting in touch with us.
Yeah, so we are at the end of our session here. So thank you so much for the attention and staying with us, although the sunlight is out there, so we get 30 minutes of sunlight now. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Enjoy the sun. Thank you.